socks off stuff, but I hope by the end of this talk that you'll learn some new things that hopefully you can apply in your clinical practice. Because this is one of the most common conditions that we see in gastroenterology. And I can tell you that as the editor of the American Journal, whenever we publish a paper on diverticular disease, we see that it gets a lot of citations because there's a great deal of interest in this very old condition that we've known about for a long time, but haven't known a lot about. So I'm going to show you some new data today that may be surprising, may not be. I want to start with a picture because I assume most of you do colonoscopy. That's why you're here. This is a gut club. And when we do colonoscopies, we find this all the time. We see diverticulosis. And in fact, if you look at epidemiologic data, this is data from the National Endoscopy Database, which comes out of Oregon Health Sciences University, something called CORI. I don't know if you guys have heard of CORI. But CORI is the Clinical Outcomes Research Initiative, C-O-R-I, which is really one of the largest endoscopic databases in the world, and a very powerful database to do lots of really different kinds of interesting research. So in this particular study, it was just a simple descriptive study looking at what are the most common things that we find when we do regular old screening colonoscopies. And look at this, the most common thing that we find in men and women, even more common than hemorrhoids, more common than polyps, and considerably more common than a normal exam with no findings, is diverticulosis. We see it all the time. So that's kind of interesting unto itself, that the fourth most common situation is a normal exam. So you might almost think, wow, diverticulosis is part of the human experience. Like, by being a human, we're going to develop diverticulosis, particularly in the Western world. So when does it become a disease? When does it explain somebody's irritable bowel syndrome symptoms? When could it go on to develop diverticulitis? These are all questions that that patients have. They have a lot of questions about these things, right? What does this mean for the patient who's found to have incidental diverticulosis in particular? Because we print out this report in the endoscopy unit, and it says, oh yeah, there are these pouches, these diverticulosis. And then the patients get it, and they say, well, what's that, right? What does that mean? You know, is that going to be causing an infection? Is it explaining my abdominal pain? What is that? Is that normal? Just basic, you know, common sense questions. And I'd be interested, maybe we'll have some discussion, see kind of what your answers are to these common questions. But I'll hope to give you some new answers today as we go through this topic briefly today.
Right. So, with that database, do they? Because I've seen this on and off over the years, where you're scoping somebody, you know, for whatever, surveillance or, you know, screening, and you'll see a tick with pus coming out of it. A single tick, usually it's somebody who's got really severe diverticulosis. Usually you're, like, you ask the patient afterwards, they don't have any abdominal pain, they don't have any fever. Usually I whip out and give them antibiotics, just, you know, because I'm worried.
Right.
But is that finding in that database of somebody encountering an infected tick?
I don't think they have a variable for that particular finding.
No diverticulitis.
Right, right. It's really diverticulosis that's described, and the extent and the amount of diverticulosis, but not whether it appeared, you know, pustular or infected. You know, we'll talk about SCAD, which is a variant of this, you know, segmental colitis associated with diverticulosis, which is a different condition. I'll talk about that briefly. But finding pus in one singular asymptomatic tick is, I'm not sure how often have you guys, has anyone else come across that routinely? Is that something you guys are seeing?
You see it?
Oh, yeah.
With pus coming out, just in a, like a screening exam?
A single one.
I just wondered if there was a slightly higher risk of perforation in those patients because of that. If we see one, there may be more than that in other patients where we don't even see the single infected tick, you know, because so many patients, yeah, they got hundreds
right.
of things. So if we're seeing them in, whatever, 0.1% of colonoscopy, it's probably there in 0.2%,
yeah.
You know?
I haven't seen anything written about that or any case series about the natural history of those. That's an interesting question. But I don't believe CORI has any data on that. That's an interesting, you know, clinical observation that I don't know what to make of that.
Yeah. Does Corey do, how, like, could you search in, look at corporation rate? Oh, yeah, it is?
I believe so. I mean, I don't have access to all the Corey data, but I believe they have outcome data like that. That's sort of the whole, that's the O in Corey, is the outcome part. So they have some natural history data on these patients in the Corey database. It's a great database. So David Lieberman, who's very famous for his colon cancer screening research in particular, created Corey. And he's still out there at Oregon. And if any of you are interested, you know, Corey really is a resource for a lot of people. So I'm sure he'd be happy to talk with any of you that want to do research using their database. That's my guess. I've just spoken on his behalf. All right. So, you know, let's talk about the chances, starting like simply here, right? Really simple stuff. If we find, if you have a patient where we do a colonoscopy for screening, and you happen to come across diverticulosis, what is the risk that you would tell the patient, what is the risk that they're going to one day develop diverticulitis? I'm curious, what do you guys say? If anyone asks you that question, maybe they don't have the insight to ask it, but they might ask you, like, what are the chances that's going to cause a problem in my lifetime?
You could ask anybody at this table.
This is an open question. Right. More like, right, these are the fellows, like, I can tell. Right there.
They love
wearing scrubs. So you want to fellows?
Yeah.
Okay. Looks like he just came straight out of the OR there. So what do you guys think? What is the risk of, I was a program director at UCLA for many years, so I know how to come if I need to. So what is the risk of, any of you guys, of diverticulitis if you just find asymptomatic diverticulosis? What do you guys think?
I tell them, like, most people don't have problems, most are asymptomatic, maybe like 10%.
Okay, so maybe a 10% chance? I didn't tell you maybe lifetime or next 10 years or something like that. Okay, up to a 10% chance. What do you guys think of that?
I'm going to go lower.
1%.
1%? Okay, so that's a factor of 10 difference. Okay.
How do you go 5%?
5%? It's like the Price is Right. You see his closest. Okay. The Price is Right, you want to underbid, right? You don't want to overbid, you lose it.
What did you say, Kurt?
Less than 10? 25%? Did I hear that? 25%? Okay. So quite a range. From 1% to 25%. Okay. So let's talk about this. So I had this question several years ago when I was getting interested in this disease. It's a funny thing, by the way. I've published a few papers on this topic, and I'm like one of the world's experts in diverticular disease by virtue of publishing like 3 or 4 papers. So there's very few people that like spend any time studying this condition. So that's for the fellows, find a common condition that no one's studying, and you can create a career out of it. Although this is only a tiny bit of what I do, but in any event, I was interested in this, and I went to the guidelines for the American College of Gastroenterology, published in our journal, the Red Journal. And to this date, this is still the most recent guidelines from 1999. Now, AGA, I'll get to their guidelines. There are some new guidelines that have come out from the AGA. I'll get to that in a second. But I went to this guideline, just for starters. And I wanted to know, when I looked at it, what does it say? And it says diverticulitis is the most common clinical complication of diverticulosis. And it affects 10 to 25% of patients with colonic diverticulum. So I heard 25%, and that's a common number. That's what I learned in medical school. I remember hearing that, like 1 in 4 people is at risk of developing diverticulitis if we find diverticulosis, 10 to 25%. So how does that number strike you guys in the middle table here? What does that seem about right?
Too high.
Why do you think it's too high?
We see a lot more diverticulosis than patients with diverticulitis.
Right.
I'd be overdiagnosed.
What's that?
Overdiagnosed.
You mean, what's to overdiagnose? The diverticulitis?
You see diverticular disease on a CT image and your ER doctor gives you.
Right. Or maybe even not a CT. Maybe just a primary care physician says, oh, you have abdominal pain? That's probably diverticulitis because it's down here. Bottom left. Like, we're used to like the hospital situation, but what about an outpatient clinic where everyone's got gastritis, right? In primary care, everyone has gastritis, and then they have other entities of the viscera, but no one's actually done an endoscopy, an image, or biopsy. So, entities are very common in primary care. I just got to finish saying that. The most common thing that we see is diverticulosis. So if that's the case, shouldn't we have like a line of people out the ER down there, you know, waiting to get in with their diverticulitis? I mean, if one in four Americans with diverticulosis is going to have an attack of diverticulitis, we should see an awful lot of this disease. I mean, we see it, right, for sure. But do we see that much of it? It seems kind of high, right? It seems kind of high. But that's what the guidelines said. So I wanted to know, and this is a lesson for our fellows, when you see something that does, for your fellows here, everybody, when you see something that doesn't make sense, you might ask questions like, well, what's the evidence behind that? And I said, oh, well, look at that. There's a reference. It's reference 3. Let me go check out reference 3. And it's 10 to 25% rep. I looked it up. Reference 3 is a paper by Parks from 1975. And by the way, this paper by Parks is referenced not just in the ACG guidelines, but in like the SSAT guidelines and the other surgical guidelines. Like all roads lead to Parks. Everything leads back to Parks. I thought, what did Parks know in 1975? I mean, there's a lot known then. I don't mean to be facetious, but it's not like we had population-based colonoscopy back then. I mean, how did we know how many people even had diverticulosis, much less the risk of them progressing to diverticulitis? What do we know back then? So well, let me look up the Parks paper. So I had to find the Parks paper. It turned out I had to send a fellow up into the stacks because it wasn't even no one had scanned the paper. So here's a Xerox copy of the Parks paper. And the Parks paper is basically a review article. And they say that between 10-25% of patients, that's based upon the work of both Jordan from 1958 and Horner from 52. I don't know if that's the same Horner, but Horner syndrome, but Horner's got involved in the 19. There's a paper from 1937, okay? So this 25% risk that's in our national guidelines that, you know, we tell our patients, which might God scare them to death, you have a 1 in 4 chance of getting like a bomb blown up in your belly and you might need to be hospitalized and may need surgery, is based upon data that goes all the way back to the mid-century and before. So it's worth kind of spending time sometimes when there are kind of clinical, you know, lore, there's lore out there, and sort of, you know, chasing down the mythology and finding out where did this come from anyway. There's a lot of things that like that we pass back and forth, and a lot of it is great, makes sense, and it's true, but a lot of it's kind of nonsense. And yeah.
Like that last line there in the paragraph, this is really cool, I love doing this, the old literature. Mm-hmm. The 40% developed at least one attack of diverticulitis. What's the rate in the population of IBS, painful IBS?
Mm-hmm. We're going to get to that.
Okay.
Yeah, you have anticipated a slot. So I will tell you what we know about the rate in IBS-like patients, and then we'll talk about what is the rate in just regular old people, right? That are not that IBS are not people too, but you know what I mean, like screening population. So this didn't seem right to me, and in fact, here is the only study that addresses your question that I'm aware of. There's been very few recent studies that evaluate progression from osis to itis. There is one study in a grand total of 119 people with abdominal pain who had IBS-like symptoms. And they followed them over 5 years, and in those patients who had symptoms, boy, that thing is really shaking. It's like dancing, is that one dancing over there? There was a 1.7% incidence over 5 years of follow-up. So in people who have symptoms, which you would think would increase their pretest likelihood of a problem, there is still less than a 2% chance in this massive population of 119 people, right? So that's probably not good enough, but even in this small study, very, very small risk, and it's only about 25%. So we published this paper back in 2013 to try and answer the question with a little bit more rigor. Did this with some of our fellows. And we decided to look at the VA system, a nice model system for this, generally older patients, but of course we have a broad range in the VA. You know, a lot of men, so it's mostly men. But it's a closed healthcare system, so we can follow people over time and really get a sense of their natural history. And in this study, we took a group of patients. Happened to be a perfect 2222, about 2,000 patients, all of whom underwent routine screening colonoscopy, and they all had diverticulosis identified at that exam. And then we followed them as long as we possibly could, which is on average about 7 to 10 years. So this is a pretty good follow-up period. And we waited to see, did they get diverticulitis? And we had a couple different definitions of diverticulitis, getting to this idea of over-diagnosing. The strict definition was they had to have a CT scan evidence with stranding, thickening, and or surgical specimen evidence. The weaker one was they just needed a PCP or somebody to say this patient has diverticulitis. So we looked at it both ways. And what we found is if we were very liberal and allowed just any old doctor to say, yeah, you have diverticulitis, there were 95 cases over the course of the follow-up period, which I'll show you more detail in a second, out of 2,000 plus patients. And that's an incidence of 6 per 1,000 patient years. And then we looked at a subset of people who had what we call the strict definition, where they had to have some, you know, imaging evidence or pathologic evidence on biopsy. And that was a 1.5 per 1,000 patient year incidence. 23 out of 2,200 ended up having something. Now, sure, maybe we missed a few people that were seen outside of the VA or whatever, but it was extremely low, certainly not a 25% chance. But what we did find when we looked at it is that we divided it up by decade, by age, at which point the diverticulosis was identified. There was a small group of people in their 40s that underwent screening colonoscopy, either because they're African-American or had a family history. That's why you're seeing some 40s. All these patients underwent routine colonoscopy for screening. And what we found, though, is that younger people, okay, if you look kind of across the spectrum here, younger people had a higher incidence rate per unit time. It's not just that they were younger, so we had more years to follow them. It wasn't like a lead time bias. It was actually per unit time, there was a faster progression. Although it was still low, you can see the cumulative hazard on the right. There was certainly a sort of stair-stepping. So this and other studies have shown the same thing, that when diverticulosis is found in a younger person, it may be biologically different than when it's found in an older person. And that is on the board exams now, having just recertified a couple years ago and written some board exam books. For those of you that are going to recertify or about to take the test, that's actually a question, might be a question, I don't know, on the exam. What do I know? So that is sort of a known fact now, that the rate of progression is faster in younger people, but still overall a very low risk of progression. Okay, so that's just an overview of what we learned from that study. Yes?
Aren't the younger people going to seek colonoscopy sooner because maybe they have some symptoms and therefore skew the results?
Right. So in this, you may be right, in this particular study, to the best of our ability, we excluded people who were coming for with symptomatic symptoms. Yeah, we were really looking as best as we could at just sort of screening colonoscopies.
I think there was
that's a possibility,
decent
though.
Data available, and there was a fairly significant blip of diverticulitis in patients in their 30s. So there was a decent study back in the 80s or 90s that was looking at, there is a young onset diverticulitis phenotype.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And I want to say, I don't know, a pretty decent number, like 20-30% of all diverticulitis are in this younger population.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't know the percentage off the top of my head, but you're correct that there is sort of a version of diverticulitis that seems to occur earlier. And that may be genetically predisposed. It may not be diet or other, you know,
yeah,
explanations. There may be some genetic predisposition, and it may be a more aggressive form of disease.
And you would miss that in the VA study.
Which one?
You would miss those.
Oh,
guys.
In the VA.
Yeah. So if you were to say all comers, like your study would be relevant to the guys at these fellows scope, right?
Uh-huh.
When you go tell your patient, oh, you have diverticulosis at the age of 70, this is your risk.
Right.
But overall, the numbers are probably a little bit higher than what your study found.
Yeah, I mean, the average age in this study was about 60 or so. But as you can see, we did have a range, although it skewed older for sure. And people don't normally come for screening colonoscopy at age 40 unless there's some reason to. So that kind of gets at this question. So maybe they're systematically different in some meaningful way. And that's why it's really more of a confounder than a biologic explanation. That's certainly possible. Very hard to tease it out retrospectively. Yeah.
But you could get in a big, like a true, we use this database, Truman database,
mm-hmm.
which is like a science based.
Yeah.
And you can sort of say, like, in all people that are 30 to 40, how many times are they given the diagnosis of diverticulitis and given antibiotics, let's say.
Right.
But that's kind
sure.
of going to be.
Yeah, no, definitely. You could. Sure. Okay, so while we're on this topic, another question is sort of what other predictors are there of developing diverticulitis? And there is another study that's looked at this by Ann Peary. She's at North Carolina, and Lisa Strait, who's up at University of Washington. And they did a very large study looking at this nationwide inpatient sample of 2 million plus people. And they found some independent predictors of being admitted for diverticulitis. And the ones that came out in their regression model were increasing age, which seems counterintuitive from what I just presented. Other than they're more likely to be admitted to the hospital, it doesn't necessarily mean they're more likely to get diverticulitis. The question here is admission to the hospital. Being white and being obese. Hard to know biologically if those are meaningful, if Caucasian race is, you know, biologically, I don't know, or obesity. With the mechanism of maybe obesity, we know could be, it is a pro-inflammatory condition. Maybe in some way that's promoting inflammation of the diverticulitis when coupled with, you know, bacterial. Consider microbiome considerations because those ticks are little safe havens for bacteria. But that's beyond what I know and beyond what I think anyone knows for sure at this point. There's been very little research on the biology of this. Okay, now I mentioned earlier that the AGA has some guidelines as well as the ACG. I kind of made fun of the ACG guidelines earlier, but here I want to point out a couple key clinical pearls of wisdom from the new AGA guidelines. These are relatively new, from 2015 by Neil Stolman. So Stolman wrote the guidelines from 1999 in the ACG, and then I guess he switched teams, and now he wrote new guidelines for the AGA. And just a couple little pointers from these guidelines, and you can go read them on your own if you're interested, but I just want to highlight a couple things. One thing is, when should we use antibiotics in people who actually have acute diverticulitis? Some kind of clinical things on the side here. And what they actually found in their literature review is maybe a little counterintuitive, because it gets to this earlier discussion about if I find a tick that has some pus coming out, what do I do about it? This isn't even that situation. This is where somebody actually shows up with abdominal pain, you know, fever, white count, this sort of, you know, triad of diverticulitis. And there have been two randomized controlled trials and two systematic reviews that have actually found, maybe surprisingly, no clear benefit, actually, of using antibiotics. And they actually question the routine use of antibiotics, as does this guideline, suggesting selective and individualized use. Now, it is important, they said, they go on to say, to emphasize that the current data are of low quality and recommendations could change as future studies are performed and so on and so forth. But as we stand here today, or sit here today, there doesn't seem to be a really clear benefit from randomized controlled trials. Now, does that mean we're going to stop using antibiotics when people come in with acute diverticulitis? I don't think so. But it might mean if somebody has low-grade diverticulitis in an outpatient setting, or you suspect they have diverticulitis, this is more of a primary care kind of consideration. Maybe hold off on the antibiotics and see how people do. Follow the natural history. If they get worse, I don't think anyone's going to fault the doctor for giving antibiotics. But it's just interesting to note this, and this is specifically called out in the new AGA guidelines. So just FYI. Another topic that comes up here is when to perform surgery after somebody has had an attack or multiple attacks of diverticulitis. So I remember when I was training, it was sort of like there were these rules, like if there have been three or more attacks, or the patient has wasn't sure if there was even evidence to support it. Well, the surgeons have had these rules for a long time, but the guidelines from 2014 from the American Society of Colorectal Surgeons says that the decision to recommend elective, in this case, sigmoid colectomy, or they're referring to sigmoid tips, after recovery from uncomplicated acute diverticulitis, it really should be individualized. And they go on to explain that despite previous emphasis on the number of attacks dictating the need for surgery, the literature demonstrates that patients with more than two episodes are not at an increased risk for morbidity and mortality in comparison with patients who have had fewer episodes, signifying that diverticulitis is not a progressive disease. And then there's more details. So there's a new NIH grant that is ongoing at the University of Washington that I'm aware of, where the surgeons up there are trying to actually collect evidence to support these guidelines and these rules, and we don't yet have the results. But the upshot is you have to just use your clinical judgment. If you find, let's say, a younger person who has had multiple attacks of diverticulitis, in light of what I've shown you epidemiologically, they have a long time to live, they have maybe a more aggressive disease, maybe it makes sense to go to surgery. An older person with two low-grade attacks and who seems to be doing fine, maybe we don't. Three attacks, maybe not, you know? Depends how severe it was, how impactful it was. Bottom line is, there's no good guidance on this. There used to be guidance that was explicit and specific, but not evidence-based. So that's the latest from that. Okay. Wonder, do you guys have any rules that you apply? Or is this more just let the surgeons figure it out?
It's really changed recently, right? I mean, it's more the severity of the attack. Right? Like if they're hospitalized, you know, high fever, and required IV antibiotics, those are the guys that you have to, at least this is what the colorectal guys have been saying. Have we had any kind of a journal club or anything about this? Probably not. But the guidelines have changed, I would say, in the last 5 years as far as the surgeons are concerned. They really don't aggressively pursue surgery like they used to.
I just noticed this is the men's table, and that's the women's table.
I have a question. Are there any studies for difference in outcomes in people who undergo surgery versus who do not?
So, in terms of outcomes after surgery?
Yeah.
Yes, there's ongoing research, and I'll touch on this a little bit later. But the University of Washington, as I mentioned earlier, is actually looking specifically at this question. The big question that comes up is people have recurrent pain, and if we take out the sigmoid or whatever disease segment, does the pain get better? I mean, do they feel better? Not just have fewer attacks, but does their, let's say, IBS symptom get better? That is a bit unknown. I'm sure each of you has some anecdotal experience around that, and sometimes we do send people to surgery because we're like, I don't know, I think you just need a sigmoidectomy at this point because you have so much abdominal pain, it's just so recurrent. And I think it's time to just get it. And it may end up being functional pain, and they still have pain when they come back. Yeah. And George Longstreth at Kaiser Southern San Diego showed this several years ago, published a nice paper, set a series of papers in gastro, demonstrating that people who have IBS end up getting a lot more surgeries than people who don't. Not surprising. And yet they continue to have IBS, continue to have symptoms in many, many cases. So I'll touch on that in the next part of the talk, actually. But I think that's maybe the spirit of your question, if I'm understanding. Okay. All right. A couple other pointers while we're in this sort of guideline quick review, and this is helpful for boards and for life. Another question that comes up clinically is if somebody does have a bona fide diverticulitis attack, should we do a colonoscopy in all of them if they haven't had one recently? And if so, how soon should we do that colonoscopy? Because the concern is always, well, boy, is there a cancer that we all missed? Or is there a cancer that, you know, triggered that attack underlying that event? So this is also addressed in the guidelines, and I'll just read a little bit. Observational studies of cohorts of patients with imaging-proven diverticulitis who subsequently underwent colonoscopy detected a small number of colorectal cancers, 15 per thousand, and advanced adenomas, 38,000. Absence of a mass lesion on CT scan does not exclude the possibility of an underlying colonic neoplasm. So they go on to say that the optimal timing of colonoscopy episode of acute diverticulitis is uncertain, but just like really good guidelines, they leave you guessing. But the severity and duration of the episode are relevant considerations. Intervals of 6 to 8 weeks after resolution are commonly followed. So there's no evidence-based criterion for this, but in general, they're saying after an attack, if somebody hasn't had a recent colonoscopy, it's probably reasonable to do a colonoscopy 6 to 8 weeks later, just to make sure there isn't a cancer underneath it.
And what is recent? What do you mean by recent? Like in the last year, 2 years?
Yeah, I mean, that's a good question that is not addressed, to my knowledge, in this guideline. You know, of course, we can miss cancers all the time with a colonoscopy. But for me, I would say, you know, geez, within the last 3 years or something like that. But that's just me saying how I would answer that question. Okay, so there's a big white screen here with two words, because so far we've been talking about diverticulosis, and we've been talking about diverticulitis, and we've been talking about the risk of going from one to the other. But for the sort of second part of the talk, I want to back out for a second and reveal that there's a lot more to this than meets the eye. And diverticular disease really is something every gastroenterologist should understand, because first of all, there's actually business to be had here. Being dollars and cents about it for a second, this is not something we should surrender to the surgeons to manage, because there is knowledge to be gained and there are treatments to give for managing these patients. This is not just a condition that surgeons manage when people show up to the hospital with acute abdominal pain and fever and diverticulitis. They also have a whole bunch of other consequences that I want to talk a little bit about here. So this is a sort of taxonomy, I guess, that we proposed in 2012 and published in this paper, and I think it's been pretty well adopted. It's not all that mysterious. The whole idea is, okay, so you have ticks, diverticulosis. The next question is, are they asymptomatic, nothing's going on, or does the patient have some kind of disease? Disease, lack of ease, meaning they have some symptoms or some complications that we think may be related to those ticks. So when we kind of break it down, all right, under diverticular disease, you can have diverticulitis, which is what I've been talking about so far. What I mean by that is there is inflammation that is macroscopically evident. Either colonoscopically, you see pus coming up, you see erythema around the tick, or on imaging, you see stranding, thickening, abscess, whatever, right? That's what we traditionally think of diverticulitis, but there's also this condition that's really important. If you remember anything from this talk, you should go home knowing a lot about SUD, because it's everywhere, right? SUD, symptomatic, uncomplicated diverticular disease. That's what SUD stands for, symptomatic, uncomplicated diverticular disease, which sounds a lot like IBS, and I'll get to that. We'll talk about SUD. Now, if I just finish up going over to diverticulitis, there could be acute diverticulitis. Oh, I show up, I've got that triad, abdominal pain, white count, fever, and so on. Or it could be chronic recurrent diverticulitis that comes in two flavors. In this case, there's chronic recurrent diverticulitis, where it kind of comes and it goes and it comes and it goes. It's kind of like just fulminating, always kind of coming back and hard to snuff it out. And then there's also SCAD, which I mentioned briefly earlier, which I'll talk about briefly, but that's a big topic unto itself from the IBD world. SCAD, symptomatic colitis, I'm sorry, segmental colitis associated with diverticulosis. It's also in some of the literature called DASC, which is just diverticular associated segmental colitis. So two people came up with different epithets, whatever, it's the same thing. Okay, DASC and SCAD, just different orders of the same letters. So I want to talk about SCAD briefly, but then I'm going to spend the rest of my time, hopefully you're still awake, you guys still look like you're awake, talking about SUD, because SUD's really, really important. So let's talk briefly about SCAD. I'm not a SCAD expert, so I'm only going to spend one, I don't know if I'm an expert in anything really, but I'm going to spend one slide just briefly talking about SCAD, very important condition. And what is this? Well, some key points. So it's sort of a form frust, which is, you know, the old Latin term, meaning kind of like an early version of a disease, not fully normally expressed, it may be a form first of IBD, but it is considered it to be a distinct disorder. It doesn't always turn into classic IBD. In some cases, it just is self-limited and goes away. But what is it? You've probably all seen it. You may not have recognized it when you saw it, or you may have. But it's pretty striking when you see it, because this is a segment of diverticulosis where you see colitis. It looks like IBD. It's not just erythema around the mouth of the colon. I'm sorry, the mouth. That's like my sleep deprivation. Not just the mouth of the tick, but between the ticks. You see the mucosa, not just around, but between the ticks, all involved and inflamed and looking like IBD. But the key thing is it's only in the areas where there is diverticulosis. The rectum is always spared. So on a board examination, if the rectum is involved, it's not scat. It may be something else, it might be infectious, it might be IBD, but it's not typically scat. So that's what it looks like. What causes it? I'm sure maybe you have some ideas, we'll talk about it, but we don't really know. Epidemiologically, it tends to be more common in older adults and more common in males. It's sort of more common in the sigmoid colon than, as I mentioned, around diverticulosis. I already mentioned it characteristically spares the rectum, but I'll repeat it. And on histology, if you take a biopsy of it, it looks like IBD. I mean, you see Paneth cell metaplasia, you could see granulomas, architectural distortion, just like you would see in IBD. But it often resolves itself and or responds to mesalamine. So that, in that regard, it's kind of like IBD. Now, it could be that, you know, in the genetically susceptible host, if you've got these ticks and you've got bacteria hanging out in those ticks, that it creates a local immune response that leads to a localized form of IBD, but it does not progress beyond that. But in some cases, it does progress and actually expresses as full-blown IBD in some cases. But as I mentioned, it's typically self-limited. Otherwise, it may be IBD. So are you some IBD experts? I don't know if you have any experience or anyone else in the room.
Occasionally, you actually even have to take out the sigmoid if it just doesn't want to get better. It typically does also respond to antibiotics as well in more severe cases. And I really am fascinated by this syndrome because I do think that it's related to the whole dysbiosis that we are dealing with IBD.
Right.
And unfortunately, you know, it's probably related to the antibiotics that the patients have gotten as well. You know, so they've gotten antibiotics, they haven't really cleared the infection. So now the immune system is dealing with this kind of smoldering,
right,
you know, bacterial infection. And then because of that, it kind of, you know, creates this immune response, which is now spread. I've even seen it up into the transverse colon in some of these guys.
Mm-hmm.
Rarely, I mean, I probably hit a couple bad ones in the beginning, but rarely, but you do have, and the guys from Mayo taught me this, occasionally the only time you get rid of it is to take out the sigmoid and be done with
right.
it that way. But you'd like to not have to do that, obviously.
Right. Right.
And actually, I would say probably the ASA response is probably 40-60%, it's not 90 or 100%.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you get an ASA response, you're lucky.
Yeah.
And I like your point about the form of too, because we had a lady who started out with, I call it diverticular colitis. Diverticular colitis, real mild, you know, and but then really progressed, got more abdominal pain, and then pathology really turned into IBD, more like a Crohn's like picture of IBD. So, maybe the earlier, or the repeated insults, repeated sensitization to bacteria kind of pushed her into the, she's a mild Crohn's, at least, you know, what I'm calling her. She's probably indeterminate. But you're right, though, no rectal disease at all,
right?
No rectal inflammation.
Right.
But they can be symptomatic, for sure.
Yeah.
And that can be annoying. You know, you got a lot of pain, and what do you do about it?
Right.
You got to fix them.
Right.
The response to the
sometimes you do. And I think this lady even developed positive serologies.
Mm-hmm. They may, sometimes they do.
Yeah.
So it looks like it may be BI, like a form of IBD.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, when that's what's happening.
Do you think
they have
antibiotics
as
well?
Yeah, I think I just mentioned that. Yeah, so antibiotics are definitely worth trying.
Mm-hmm.
if you were 65 and I told you that you could either go on anti-TNF or take your segment, take your sigmoid colon out, what would you rather have? Well, I'm just saying if I said, I don't really know obviously how, but if I said, okay, if I start you on anti-TNF, you're gonna have to stay on it versus just take the sigmoid, you're done. I think a lot of people would just take the sigmoid and be done. Problem is we don't know the real long-term history.
Right, so that's right. It's pretty rare conditions.
Yeah.
Okay. You guys behind the pole okay? Behind the pillar? I can't really see you guys behind the pillar. Okay, everyone's good? You guys good over there? Just checking in. Ladies tables okay? Okay. You guys over here okay? All right. Separation. So let me now just turn my attention to SUD. Talk a little bit about SCAD, but let's talk about SUD. So SUD, the real issue here is, like everyone has IBS. That's not true. About 10% of America has IBS, 7 to 10%. That might as well be everyone in a GI clinic. It's about 30% of a GI clinic is IBS. So, and some of those people have diverticulosis, because I just showed you all these people have diverticulosis. So the question is, among the people who have IBS and diverticulosis, is it the diverticulosis that's causing the IBS? Or are they just like, is it true and unrelated? Like, yes, you have IBS, yes, you have an MTIC, and they have nothing to do with each other. Okay, that's sort of the question here. And it turns out, if you look at SUD, where we're defining it as people who have IBS-like symptoms, abdominal pain, diarrhea, urgency, cramping, in the setting of diverticulosis, when they've been studied, and there's been a number of studies that have looked at different aspects of these patients, there are some similar symptoms as IBS, and they overlap in cross-sectional studies, and there's overlapping pathophysiology. So in these patients with SUD, when they biopsy them, they will, in some cases, have documented, some of these authors, evidence of inflammation. There's low-grade microscopic inflammation, not macroscopic. You don't see it, you don't see SCAD, you don't see redness everywhere, but you do see lymphocytic infiltrate in some cases, or just inflammatory infiltrate. And that's also been shown in IBS without diverticulosis. There have been studies identifying alterations in gut microbiota, in visceral hypersensitivity, and in abnormal colonic motility, which are exactly the same pathophysiologic mechanisms that have been discussed for years underlying irritable bowel syndrome, which is a complex disorder that has many, many different potential explanations and theories. But these are some of them, and they've also been shown in this condition. So here's a question that we wanted to answer that's just very clinically oriented. Is, all right, let's just get back to the clinic here for a second. That's kind of always my orientation. It's like, what do people care about? The clinic, common questions, let's answer them. All right, if somebody gets acute diverticulitis, they get better, they get their antibiotics or whatever, what is their chances that they're going to go on to get IBS, all right? We have all heard of post-infectious IBS, right? PIIBS, you guys are familiar with that? You're familiar? Are you post-cough? No, you're asleep. I'm allowed to say that, right? Can I say that?
We're going to have to invite more program directors.
This is tough.
Wait for you guys. All right, so you've all heard of post-infectious IBS, but is there something called post-inflammatory IBS? Is there post-diverticulitis IBS? Most experienced clinicians, and they're meeting in the room, we'll say, I have seen patients who were fine, then they got an attack of diverticulitis, they were treated, but they've never been the same ever since. They have abdominal pain, they have diarrhea, they have bloating, they have urgency, and it's not like they have a diverticulitis, because they don't, it's gone, but they have something's wrong with their body. We heard that, so we did a study, again in the VA, and we wanted to answer this question. Is there increased risk for irritable bowel syndrome after acute diverticulitis? So we did this study, and I want to first, before I fill in the data, just explain what you're about to see. What we're looking at here in a second is we took a group of people who had an attack of acute diverticulitis, again at the VA, None of them had IBS before their attack. Okay, we ruled it out. And then we followed them, and we looked to see after the attack, did they start to accumulate new diagnoses of IBS? But then the important thing is we had a control group who also came to the hospital on the same day for another condition, age and sex matched, and we followed them to see if they developed IBS. So there's a control group, that's the important thing. And what we found when we looked at these two groups side by side is that the people who had acute diverticulitis were about 5 times more likely to accumulate a diagnosis of IBS compared to people who came to the hospital age and sex matched controls on the same day for some other condition. So we thought, okay, well that's, it doesn't prove it at all, but it certainly looks like there's an increased spike of, and it, by the way, it wasn't just like in the days around the attack. For months later, this continued to accumulate. This is over 100 months. This was a pretty long follow-up. So we looked at it a second way. We said, let's just look not at IBS, but at any functional GI disorder. Functional dyspepsia, functional constipation, functional diarrhea, and IBS. And we looked at it a different way, and again, we saw that there was this separation, about a 2.5-fold increase risk of getting some kind of functional GI disorder after an attack. So we said, all right, let's look at it from a different perspective completely. Now we're going to ask a different question. What is the incidence of new onset depression, diagnosed with depression after this attack, compared to a control group? Now everyone's eligible to become depressed. Is there some reason why an attack of diverticulitis would cause depression at a higher rate than, let's say, a heart failure exacerbation or a COPD or asthma exacerbation? Well, the idea is, well, we know that functional GI disorders are comorbid with psychosocial distress and depression, anxiety in particular. So we kind of went out on them and very hypothesis testing, but again, we saw this distinction. And this was a roughly two-fold increased risk that was statistically significant. So what we showed in a few different analyses is that after somebody has an attack, they have abdominal pain, it persists in many patients, and it looks like they start getting diagnosed with IBS at a higher rate. This is retrospective evidence suggesting the existence of post-diverticulitis IBS. We do not have a prospective study that has been able to confirm this at this time. But it does, in my experience, align with a lot of physicians' experiences and with more data that I'll show you in a second. I'm curious, have you guys seen this phenomenon in your practice? People have an acute attack of a diverticulitis, and then they come back, you know, 6 months later, a year later, and they're still having symptoms. And
I totally agree about the IBS. I wonder, I don't know if you're able to do this, is it possible to look to see if they had a history of depression before the attack?
Yeah, we ruled those people. We ruled out these are new diagnoses.
Okay. No depression prior.
Correct.
Okay.
In this analysis.
Yeah.
Correct.
No, that's really interesting. I was just thinking that depression could alter your microbiome too, so
right.
Could that have set
sure.
you
Sure, yeah, brain gut access stuff,
yeah.
Right.
Have you seen?
Yeah, but I'm just wondering, is it related to diverticular disease or the use of antibiotics?
Mm-hmm.
That mm-hmm.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It could be.
Really?
Yeah, don't know. Mm-hmm. Don't know, could not say that. Almost everyone got antibiotics on a study within the mm-hmm. Are you guys still with me? Do I need to wrap up? Probably soon, right? Wrap up soon. You guys have got to get home. So let me finish up with a couple things here. We were really intrigued by this finding, and we thought, why don't we do a different kind of study? So I'm showing you different kinds of research studies, clinical research methodologies. And in this case, we did very qualitative research. I showed you this big data, these big massive epidemiologic studies, but now we're looking at qualitative. We just interviewed people and we talked to them and we learned about their experiences. So what we did here is this is called development and validation of a disease-targeted quality of life instrument for chronic diverticular disease. It's called the DBQOL, which is a questionnaire that's actually widely used around the world now, surprisingly, translated in multiple languages, that actually measures quality of life specific to diverticular disease. But what I want to highlight here is not so much that kind of academic psychometric stuff. But I want to show you, this isn't really meant to be read yet. This is a map of the themes and the and talked to them and found out what their lives were like. It's very qualitative. And we coded what we recorded all the transcripts, and we had social scientists kind of code all the language. And what we found was that there were all sorts of interesting symptoms these people described having. They said that they had new sort of constipation, or urgency, or diarrhea, or they had pain, fatigue, dizziness, clamminess, sweatiness, tightness, fullness, swelling, distension. Sounds kind of like IBS to me. They said, oh, I have this, this is a map of where their pain persisted after the attack. This is after the attack, not during the attack. They talked about all these worries, like all of a sudden they feel infected, like they're dying inside, like they've been poisoned, afraid that they have cancer now. They're confused, embarrassed. They feel like they have a lack of control over their bowels. They're having trouble concentrating, anxiety, frustration, depression, isolation, stigma, sexual problems now that were new, sleep problems. Wow, that's a whole bunch of stuff. And it looks like, I mean, it's part of the human condition. I don't know if it's specific to diverticulitis, but they didn't, in these cases, I mean, these patients did not feel that way until after they had the attack. And it kind of looks like they have IBS-type symptoms to me. So that was fascinating to us, and it kind of suggested that there may, in fact, be something called PDV, post-diverticulitis IBS, but we really need more research on this. All right, I want to finish shortly, but I just want to talk briefly about, okay, great, so how do we treat this then? If you do think you have somebody who has SUD, what do we know about the treatment for these patients? Is it the same as IBS? Is it different from IBS? Well, this is a little framework we created in this paper, where these are the different pathophysiologic mechanisms that are proposed to drive symptomatic diverticular disease. And if you think about these, then you can map different, you know, therapies to them. And the question is, you know, what is the evidence that these therapies actually help in SUD, as opposed to IBS, in patients with SUD? So the first study I want to point out was a study by, there's Neil Stolman again, where he did a randomized controlled trial in these patients looking at GI symptoms in people who got 5-ASA products plus probiotics, plus or minus probiotics versus placebo. So there was a group who got placebo, a group who got mesalamine, a group who got mesalamine and probiotic, and you know, placebo works really well in for abdominal pain, so it worked well for all of them. And there was a little separation, but by the end of the study, there was not a statistically significant benefit of 5-ASA in this particular study. And a new study from 2017 is looking now not at symptoms, but at preventing new diverticulitis attacks using 5-ASA in these patients versus placebo. And I'll ask the fellows, how do you interpret this, these findings? Anyone at this table here? What do you guys think? Can you read that?
It's more statistically.
Yeah, so what we're looking at is the percentage of patients who are free of an attack over the course of the study period. On the right, those who have on placebo, on the left, those who are on mesalamine, and then down below, what is the down below? This is showing, just look at the top one for a second. I can't actually remember what it did. So what did you say?
So placebo has more than the mesalamine, but it's not specifically.
Right, so higher is better. In this case, 100% would mean no one had an attack. That means attack-free. That's what this is saying. So actually, it was better to be on a placebo than it was to be on mesalamine, although it was not statistically significant in either direction. There was, you know, just numerically slightly higher risk of being, or higher risk meaning lower percentage here. It's a little confusing. So the bottom line is ASAs did not work, did not help prevent attacks whatsoever. So this was a big deal at the time. I think one of the big drug companies was trying to push 5-ASA for diverticulitis, and it did not work. So that was a big negative. What does seem to work for SUD, based on meta-analysis, is rifaximin. And what you're looking at here is two forest plots looking at, on the left, just looking at symptom reduction, and on the right, looking at diverticulitis prophylaxis. And I'm also depicting it in terms of the number needed to treat, which is a very important statistic whenever we're looking at therapies. So the number needed to treat according to this study, and you can see these data go all the way back to 1992, rifaximin's an old drug, suggests that there is a statistically significant benefit for symptom benefit in sudden. And the number needed to treat was as low as 3, which is very low, very low. And on the right, the number needed, there was a statistically significant pooled risk reduction, although the number needed to treat was 50. So a much larger, much smaller effect size, meaning you need to treat many, many more people to prevent diverticulitis attacks. But it's but it is statistically significant. Yeah.
So how long do you treat for?
I think it varied in these studies, but generally it was 10 to 14 days.
And the effect size is varied for how long?
That's a good question. The duration of the studies, which generally are short, so we're talking about like 3 to 6 month studies. Right. So hard to know beyond that what the persistent benefits are. Just like with IBS. I mean, we had this problem with IBS too.
Yeah.
But at least in the short term, there does appear to be a statistically significant benefit. Okay. Should we just give people fiber? Right? This is all for forever and ever been how we've sort of told people how to manage their symptomatic diverticulosis. Well, there's nothing wrong with fiber, except it can cause bloating and diarrhea in some people. But there have been some more recent large epidemiologic studies that have looked at this question, and they've really called into question whether low dietary fiber is even a risk factor in the first place for diverticulosis. I mean, we all learned that. We all learned that, oh, you know, there's too much pressure and it blows out the teeny E. coli and the big thick muscles and everything blows out. We don't really know if that's even true. And these epidemiologic studies don't suggest that. It's totally unclear whether dietary interventions can modify the risk of diverticular complications. And there's virtually no data in SUD, as opposed to IBS, where there is some data, but in SUD, there's small uncontrolled retrospective studies. We really don't know if fiber therapy works in SUD. We do know in IBS, if you look at the meta-analysis, first for Bran, then Ispagula husk, and then fiber overall, that there is a slight statistically significant benefit of using fiber in IBS. The upper confidence bound actually touches the line of unity at 1, so it's barely statistically significant. It's a paper that I was on, and the number needed to treat is 11 for using fiber in IBS. So yeah, it's pretty harmless, and maybe works barely, but we don't know if it works in SUD. Okay. This comes up a lot. I swear I'm almost done, so I'm just about done. What about, you know, should people avoid nuts? Should they avoid seeds? Should they avoid, you know, popcorn? I was taught to do that. You probably were. I'm guessing you may even still say that. There's been only one study that's looked at this. It's a very large database study, again by Lisa Strait in JAMA. And what they did in this study, it was a pretty good study, it was in JAMA. They looked at 42,000 people, and they basically found no relationship whatsoever to the amount of seeds, nuts, popcorn that people eat and their risk of a diverticulitis attack. Now, these are big, large studies, so any one patient, maybe, you know, I can't tell you don't, but it's a lot of, you know, it's a lot to request somebody to do without clear data. But that said, every time I present this, there's always somebody in the audience who's like, yeah, well, I saw a case. You know, everyone's seen a case. You know, like, I saw a popcorn kernel sitting in the tick. I mean, it was right there. And I know we've all seen it, so I don't know. I don't have to tell you, except these are the data.
I wanted to take you back to something you said earlier, just about that there may be different entities of this disease. There's an older version, but then going back to the younger, because actually in my case, my brother had diverticulitis, actually perf.
Oh, wow.
Spontaneously perf.
Yeah.
And then just last September, I had really bad diverticulitis.
Oh, my goodness. A lot of personal experience.
Yeah, so two siblings, right, that had pretty aggressive diverticulitis, and I wonder if there is a separate entity that is familial, kind of like there is sometimes in Barrett's, right?
Right.
But that's maybe different than, so maybe the approach
could well be, isn't it? I mean, it's probably some SNP or something that somebody needs to find. Yeah, no doubt about it. Okay, I'm done, I'm finishing this, and I'll let you guys go, but if you're interested in this topic, we wrote a paper about this. And that's all I got for you today.
Do you have a sense of things?
Yeah.
Whether or not the incidence is increasing over time, like a lot of other things that we deal with?
That's a good question, and I'm trying to think if I've seen data on that. I'm sure data exists, but I can't cite you study. Now, I did mention that obesity is an independent risk factor for diverticulitis, and we know that the obesity epidemic. So I wouldn't be surprised if the incidence is going up, but I don't know a study offhand, but I'll bet you there is one.
Any thoughts on why that tremendous spike in depression between the, what was it, the 60 and 80th month?
I haven't really thought about that. I can pop that back over. Yes, you're right. I have a feeling that's more of a statistical anomaly, that the sample size is getting smaller at that point and you're seeing more larger swings. That's what I think is happening, but I don't know. I don't know if there's something. It might be, I don't know. It might be that that's a point when they're coming back to the doctor. I don't know. That's a good question. I haven't thought about that. Never heard that question. That's a good question. Yeah.
Okay, so how many questions do you have?
I don't want to miscite the percentage, other than to say it is a higher percentage than the general population, but I can't remember exactly how much higher. So there, I did. I have probably too many slides to go back to it, but there is. I cited earlier a couple cross-sectional studies that have looked at that. Simply looking at the prevalence of IBS, of diverticulosis in IBS versus controls, and it is higher. I just don't remember the exact magnitude. But if you go to that review article I cited, just sort of pull up some of the papers, you can get that out. I just don't remember. That's a good question. Yeah.
Where you have the tree, you know, that breaks everything down for symptomatic.
Yeah.
You have, is there a pathway there? Yeah, for the diverticulitis to go back to the SUD? Because I have a patient that had complicated diverticulitis, chronic abscess, and now probably has some.
Absolutely. I mean, that's really, this whole section of the talk is about, and this paper is really getting at that connection. So somebody is in the clear-cut diverticulitis category. They're you know, we deal with it, either surgery or antibiotics or no antibiotics. We're going to follow the HA guidelines. And then the question, then they just fall, but then they end up really moving over to the SUD category.
But then does it seem right to just call it uncomplicated, or is it it's now a different disease?
It's hard to know if SUD and PD, VIDS are the same. We don't really have the vocabulary yet to say. In my mind, they're clinically very similar. Maybe they're different in terms of how they got there. But clinically, they're similar, and I wouldn't know how to treat them any differently based upon their slightly differing histories. But I think they're pretty much the same condition.
Is there post-infectious IBS? I mean, I'm kind of stealing from another topic.
Yeah.
Is the post-infectious IBS a little bit more easy to treat? I mean, is it more likely that you'll extinguish it versus a, you know, garden variety IBS? In your clinical experience?
Yeah, sort of, yeah. So it's kind of interesting because we're starting to learn that it may be a seropositive form of IBS. So there is an antibody that you may be aware of. Maybe you've heard of this IBS check. I don't know if you guys have seen it, heard of IBS check. So IBS check is an antibody test. It was actually invented by discovered by Mark Pimentel at Cedars-Sinai, where I work. And it's an antibody to a protein called vinculin, which is actually a structural protein in the sort of myenteric plexus. And the whole concept is that in some people with IBS, they get infected with Clostridium or some other, you know, gram-negative rod, and there's an immune response to that bacteria. The immune system tries to clear that bacteria, but in the process, creates an antibody that cross-reacts with some epitope on the surface of the bacteria that also mimics, that appears to mimic vinculin. which is a structural protein in the myenteric plexus. So long after the bacteria is gone, people continue to have persistent symptoms and sort of low-grade inflammation and diarrhea. And in a large number of them, they test positive for anti-vinculin. And it's also anti-CDT, Clostridium cytolethal descending toxin B, I think is the other antibody. So there's actually two antibodies. So anyway, those patients, we think, are more likely to respond to antibiotics, those who have the seropositive form, almost like an autoimmune form of IBS compared to others. So that's really an evolving, very interesting area, is having biomarkers. And, you know, we think of IBS, but IBS is, like, I mean, there's only so many ways the GI system can present itself. Pain, diarrhea, bloating. It turns out all of gastroenterology, I'll discuss this tomorrow, can be summarized with 8 symptoms. So, like, it's hard to tell what the real causes of somebody's symptoms. It's important to have biomarkers to help distinguish. Just like in IBD, we all know the role of biomarkers there. In functional GI, we're starting to get a better sense of what the biomarker should be and the clinical implications of how that should change our treatment. And really, all I've been talking about today is diverticulosis is a biomarker. Mm-hmm. Having the tick is a biomarker that may have clinical implications in these IBS patients.
Thank you so much. Okay, more questions,
Any more questions? You got? I'm here all night.
I'm a little confused with that. Matt, you said at the beginning, the incidence roughly 5% per year?
I think it's per 1,000.
Is that diverticulitis incidence?
Diverticulitis incidence, yeah.
If you take that over a lifetime, would that be?
Yeah, it's per 1,000. 1.5 per 1,000 patient years. So I do have a slide that will give you the actual. Here, I hid the slide that you may be asking about. Let me see if this answers your question. Here. So this is showing now by different age groups. You can see the sample sizes that we are dealing with in this particular study. And then the absolute number of cases over the course of the study, which is about a 7-year median follow-up. Total person years, the proportion that ended up with diverticulitis, and then the incidence per 1,000 patient years of Compton syndrome. So those are two different, like the proportion, you multiply by 100, you know, 2 out of 21 is actually pretty high, but it's such a small sample size. Mm-hmm. So you can see the absolute, everything you need to kind of do your calculations are here for you. And we published this in the paper just to give more practice. It's hard to get your mind around, what does that mean, 1.5 per 1,000 patient years? It's a little better to say, like, what is the probability, really? I mean, you know, percentage chance. And in this case, it's proportion times 100, yes. So it's closer, it varies. You can see it goes all the way up to 9.5% and lower. But it's not 25%. No.
Totally off the subject.
Uh-huh.
Since you're from the West Coast,
yeah.
Any quick thoughts on the romaine epidemic?
The romaine epidemic? Oh, the romaine lettuce epidemic? Is this this new virus or something? I don't know anything about the romaine lettuce epidemic. Is it listeria? I haven't even been following this. Is there a new epidemic I should know about? Yeah. Do you have thoughts about it?
No.
Okay.
Stay away from me.
Stay away from lettuce. Interesting.
That is an item, TCA.
Yes.
What I was going to
make about that is we don't know the role of TCAs in SUD. There's no data. But the only data we have to help inform the discussion is what do we know about its role in irritable bowel syndrome, because again, I'm just using that as the closest analog. And there has been several randomized control trials of TCAs versus placebo in IBS. Okay, and this is a meta-analysis of those studies. And when you look at all of them together, there is a statistically significant benefit, that's that diamond at the bottom, about a 32% relative reduction of symptoms, number needed to treat of 4.
You're right. Okay. Okay, you guys have been here all